Good evening. Turn your hymnals to 239. 239. There's a deep, settled peace abiding in my soul since I have found a friend divine. He from sin did release, now love weighs on me wrong. The victory today is mine. Victory, victory, victory is mine. I've had it in my soul since Jesus made me whole. Once my soul was in doubt, so often I had cried, Lord, lead me to the glory line. Now with joy I can shout, for I am satisfied, the victory today is mine. Victory, victory, victory is mine. I've had it in my soul since Jesus made me whole. So while time here shall last, I'll labor, watch, and pray. My life for him each day shall shine. For with love holds me fast, he's with me night and day. The victory today is mine. Oh, victory, victory, victory is mine. I've had it in my soul since Jesus made me whole. Of the way, close by the eastern gate, my friends and loved ones I shall find. Soon will time bring the day, they have not long to wait. The victory today is mine. Oh, victory, victory, victory is mine. I've had it in my soul since Jesus made me whole. Victory, victory, victory.
Kids come and sing. Tonight's offering goes to missions. I almost forgot it's good to have my Mamaw Brown back here at Beach Fork. We had to get her out of that house. We went on had a good time today, went golf cart ride, and I was like, well, won't we go to church tonight? She said, okay. So it's always good to have her back out. Come on, kids, go ahead and come on out.
Thank you.
Good job, kids. All right, we'll go ahead and start. We'll go ahead and start Ralph off tonight. He wants to sing again. He feel like he's got the energy. I'll tell you what, that ought to put us young people to shame. It should.
Something to tell, so I'll start at the first. While on my knees I fell, I asked for mercy, and it was supplied. Now my sins are forgiven, I have nothing to hide. Just want to tell you, setting of a sun. When life's work here is through, I'm coming home to be with you. Just want to tell you I'm thankful, that's all. Now when I feel discouraged, you're there to see me through. Of all the friends I've had, Lord, there's no friend like you. All my needs you have supplied. Oh, it makes me wanna cry. Just wanna tell you I'm thankful, that's all. I'm really thankful.
They say this mountain can't be moved. They say these chains will never break. But they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name.
We'll see a miracle, God, we believe.
From birth, the only one who saw his word didn't pass him by. He heard his cry. He rubbed his eyes in a pool of clay. Then he said, "Go and wash in the pool today." And the blind man knew this what he had to do. You know, along the way he couldn't help but trip and fall. Each time he got back up again, I wonder if he thought, every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me, I won't lie, just like that blind man. Sometimes I felt all alone, like all hope was gone. And I know that his word is true, and no matter what I'm going through, he promised me that he would never leave. I know along the way that I may stumble and I may fall, but I'll make it to the water, even if I have to crawl. Oh, every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me, waiting in the water. I know he knows where I am, and somehow this is in his plan. So until my healing comes, I'll keep pressing on, and every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me, I walk on and just believe he hears my prayer. And when I get there, the miracle promised by my Father
Good singing. All right, New Life, go ahead and make your way up here.
Longing for home, and this first verse I sing is exactly how I feel. Because the Lord's been good to me. I got no complaints. There's one thing the devil can't stand, and that's when he thinks he's got one of God's children down and beating them up pretty good. And they come to the house of God and start praising the Lord anyway. That's one thing the devil can't stand. But I'm telling you, there's one in heaven taking record of that, and he's on our side tonight. And he inhabits that praise. So we've got a lot to be thankful for. We've got a lot to be thankful for. So we're going to sing you this. We've sang it a lot, but been requested tonight, so we'll do our best. So good to me on this journey. He has blessed me with friends and a family so dear, a humble place to reside, and food on my table.
Shall not grow weary. New hands of water.
Jesus, I'll be. Strong while the ages roll away, and when I get to heaven on that beautiful strand, I'll put on the crown and I'll walk around all over God's promised land. I'll put on the crown and walk around all over God's promised land.
Back with us. It really is. We're so happy to see you tonight. And Tyson pushed you out tonight. Well, I'm glad he did. I'm good to see you tonight. It's, well, you guys are awful quiet tonight. Our Sunday school teacher called us deadbeats this morning because we was quiet in there, but I won't do that to you tonight. But I'm kind of in one of them moments, Burnett, right now, you see. Yeah, but that's okay. She was right. We was deadbeats. So, but if you have your Bibles tonight, we're going to be in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, we're going to be talking about some different places in the Word tonight. But, you know, this plan of salvation and this living for the Lord and coming to church and trying to do the best we can do and living for Him the best we can live, you know who that's up to? It's up to you. It's up to you. So if I were to title this message tonight, it would be this: it's up to you. It's up to you. We can get up here and preach till we lose our teeth, and I have. We can get up here and beg and plead and try to get you to come to the, but it all winds down to this: it's up to you. You have to make up your mind. And as I was thinking about this message today, my old, good old golf buddy, Bob DeMint, come to mind when I was thinking about this message today. And this is Bob's testimony. He ain't shared it in a long time, but I'll share it for him. He made the excuse that he couldn't come to church because it was his golf day on Sunday. That's what you said, wasn't it, Bob? Well, Bob got hooked up with Nancy, got him a good woman, and they started dating, eventually got married. And one Sunday morning, Bob realized it was up to him. He made his way down that to an altar prayer, didn't understand all of it, and has become one of the greatest Christians I know. If I had something wrong with me and I needed a prayer through, I wouldn't think twice about calling Bob DeMint to pray for me. And I got to thinking about that today. It's all up to you. And the ones that have made that step and the ones that have made that choice have become great Christians and become great people in our community because they have made that choice. That's how important it is for you as a young person to get a hold of this thing now and avoid all the scars of life and all the things that's going to damage you through your life. Get this thing now. Make it a commitment now. Make it a commitment now. Well, in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, I'm going to read one verse. It says this. Chapter 1, verse 20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. So that they are without excuse. So this thing that's all up to you and you don't do it, there ain't no excuse going to hold water for you when you stand before God. There ain't no lawyer you can call, no friends you can come to your rescue because you have chose not to do this thing. It's going to be on you. It's going to be on you tonight. You know, the first two chapters in Genesis tells us that in the beginning, our world was formless, empty, dark. But then God gave shape to this world. He brought light into darkness and he filled the emptiness with life. And the Bible tells us that when God looked upon everything that he had made, he said, it is good. It is good. That's his words. But you know what? Not everybody was happy about that, Tate. Not everybody was happy about that. There was an angel by the name of Lucifer who tried, we know him as Satan, who tried to go against God and rebel against God. So God cast him and a third of the angels that was with him out of heaven. Satan learned that he could not. I want you to get this right here. If you don't get anything else, get this little nugget right here. Satan learned at that time right there that he could not overcome God. Now, I've served the Lord since 1986. Have I been perfect? Absolutely not. I've made a lot of mistakes. I've messed up. I've had to ask the Lord to forgive me several times and to stay on the right road. But there's one thing I do know for sure, that I got God on my side. So therefore, Satan cannot overcome me. He cannot come against me. He cannot cross the bloodline that's been around me. He can't do those things. That's Bible. That's Scripture. He learned that he couldn't overcome God, so Satan focused his attack on one thing, God's favorite creation, which is you and I. That's where his attack began. And that's what he focused on, is to go against us. If you are a born-again Christian tonight, Satan will never stop attacking you. He will come with attack after attack. Satan's goal is to bring chaos into this world. And it doesn't take a very smart person to realize that in many areas, he has been successful. Look around you. You can see chaos and confusion everywhere in the United States. And I'll tell you, for instance, there's confusion about roles between men and women. We're confused as a society who's a man and who's a woman. We are. Transgender now is taking over. It's taking over the television. It's taking over our entire world. It's just becoming, and we've got a, and I'm not trying to get political here, but we got a group in the White House that's pushing them farther and farther down our throats. The Bible says it's abomination.
It's an abomination. But yet the United States welcome it and pat it on the back. We're confused about men and women, who they are. Husbands and wives, mothers and fathers. Many of them seemed unsure of their roles. They don't have a clue. Young people are confused about their place with the family. They're often so rebellious against authority. This world in general has took the word respect and has thrown it out the passenger window. They have. They've thrown it out the window. You know, when I was a child, I'm going to tell this on myself. When I was a child, my mom had me so scared of the law when she would say, uh-oh, there's a state patrol. I'd hide in the car. I'd get down, I'd hide. I'd think he was going to get me or something. You know what I'm saying? What was she doing? She was teaching me that they got authority over me. And that's one thing these young people can't stand is for anybody to have authority over them. And I mentioned this last time. Tom mentions it a lot when he preaches. We pat them on the shoulder and we don't make their behind red anymore. That's why they don't realize what authority is. They do wrong, they need to be punished. Not taken to the Dairy Queen, not buy another iPad or another iPhone, but tear into them. Let them know that you're in charge. That's what this thing's all about. We're confused about these things. We're confused about the value of life. What do you mean, Doug? Well, abortion got shot down here a few weeks ago by our Supreme Court. Thank God. It got shot down. They said it's over. They ain't going to do it anymore. So what does our feeble-minded president do? He passes this executive order for these people to have safe travel to go to other places to have these abortions. Now, to be funded by taxpayers. Now, that's just another shove down your throat. Now, I'm not up here preaching politics, so don't anybody get mad at me. But I could go a little deeper if I wanted to, but I won't. I won't. I'll stop right there. We don't even know the value of life anymore. At conception, when there's a heartbeat, that's life. That's life. They think more of their dog than they do their kid, most people do. I'm telling you the truth tonight. We are confused, and Satan is capitalizing on all these things. He's capitalizing on them. Satan is attacking this, attacking and causing chaos and rebellion and confusion, and he's killing our children all at the same time. What do you mean there, preacher? Do you know that there was over 500,000 ER visits from teenagers from drug abuse from ages 10 to 24 last year in the United States? In the United States, each day in this great country, hear me now, each day in this great country, there's an average of over 3,600 suicide attempts by young people ages 10 to 24. Tell me Satan ain't fighting against us and attacking against us. Most of these kids ain't even at the age of accountability yet, 10 to 24. Satan works hard every day to destroy God's favorite creation, you and I. He's sending attack after attack after attack. He'll keep coming, no matter your age. He's coming after you, and he is coming. Just think about what happened tonight in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve chose to listen to Satan and not God. Their perfect world was shattered, and the place became sin and death. You know what? Long after the flavor of the fruit was forgotten, Adam and Eve were still paying. We're still paying the price. Still paying the price for the decision they made. Now listen. Satan likes to climb up on our shoulder and tell us we really need that when the Holy Spirit's saying no. So what I'm saying here is long after the flavor of the fruit was forgotten, Adam and Eve was still paying a price for their decision. Can I tell you, if Satan's telling you it's okay, you better leave it alone. You better leave it alone. If he's telling you to go for it, everybody else is doing it, young people, you better leave it alone. You better leave it alone. And today, Satan depends upon us to make unwise choices. He depends upon us to have a desire to rebel against God and to fulfill our own lust. See, here's an example. Achan traded away his whole life, his whole family, for a shackle of silver, a wedge of gold, and a Babylonian garment. He traded it all away. Also, Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of soup, just to satisfy his temporary hunger. For one moment with Bathsheba, David opened up himself and his family to generations of misery. I'm trying to warn you tonight. Satan always tries to make us think that we're getting a good deal. That's his job. So we choose a moment of pleasure, a little economic gain, and in reaching all that, we discover that we have given up everything. And that's how Satan works. And when that happens, we look for someone else to blame. I'm getting to the message right here. We're looking at someone else to blame. In the third chapter of Genesis, we see God walking in the Garden of Eden, following the temptation of Adam's sin and temptation. And God asked Adam, he said, "Adam, where art thou? Where art thou?" You know what that meant? Adam, what have you done? That's what that meant. Adam, what have you done? Adam said, "Don't blame me, God, don't blame me. It wasn't my fault. It was that woman you gave me. It was that woman you gave me. She enticed me, and I ate of the forbidden fruit." Well, how about you, Eve? Oh, don't blame me. It was that serpent that you put in the garden to deceive us. He talked me into eating the fruit. And most of us, when our sins are found out or uncovered, we're looking for an scapegoat. We're looking for someone else to blame besides ourselves. Here's what we say to God. Point number one. It's somebody else's fault. It's not mine. It's somebody else's fault. You know what? I've been on this way a good little while. Been around here my whole life. And I've heard people actually say this. They say this. They'll say, "Well, don't blame me. You got to blame my parents. My dad was an old soak and he was always out playing cards and catting around, and my mom was always bitter and talking down about everybody in the community. So don't blame me, preacher. Blame my raising. Blame the way I was raised." I've actually heard people say that. But the Bible doesn't allow us to give excuses. The Word says you are responsible for yourself. And we will be held accountable for our attitudes and our actions one day when we stand before God. Others will shift the blame to those around them. Though how many times have we heard, "I know that it was wrong, but everybody else was doing it, so I thought I'd do it too." We conveniently tend to find something or someone else to blame. Now, you teachers that are here tonight, when you catch your student doing something wrong and you call them out, maybe you're not allowed to do that anymore, but I know when I was in school, they'd call you out. They'd call you out. They would. They'd single you right out, sometimes make you stand up. And they'd pour it on you a little bit there. You had to take it. And you had to take it. What is the first thing you want to do when that happens? Oh, that was Rick Rothwell sets across here. He started that. I didn't do that. That was Rick. That's what we, and you probably would do it. And that's what we do. We want to blame somebody else always. "Oh, God, it ain't my fault. It ain't my fault. My buddy was doing that, or my friend was doing that." We find someone else to blame. It's always someone else's fault. That's the way this world operates. And I'll tell you another one. How do I know this to be true? Why are lawyers so rich? you can't even hardly get into a lawyer. What are they doing? They're blaming someone else on your behalf. That's exactly what they're doing. They're fighting. They're fighting. But when we stand before Almighty God in judgment, we can't call anybody. I've already said that. We can't ask for any help. We can't ask for nothing. We got to stand alone. We all be judged. There's no escaping judgment. None whatsoever. Then point number two. Point number two. Have you ever heard people say this? Well, the devil made me do it. The devil made me do it. When we run out of excuses, when we can't blame our buddies or our friends, we'll say, well, the devil made me do it. In today's world, it seems like that everyone is looking for ways to get off the hook by finding someone else or something else to blame. But I want you to notice that the Bible never teaches that the devil can force you to sin. Yes, I said that. That's true. The devil cannot force you to sin. Did you know that? The Bible teaches that the devil is a deceiver. John 8:44 tells us, we are told that the devil is the father of lies. So he lies to us, he deceives us, manipulates us, and tempts us. But why? Why does he do those things? Because he does not have the power to force us. He doesn't have the power to force us. If we could, if he could, he would force us to sin. There would be no need for temptation. There would be no need for manipulation if the devil could make us do it. He would just force us to do it. But he can't force you to sin tonight. You must choose to do that. You must choose to go against God's will. And it's this simple. It's this simple tonight. This simple. If you're lost tonight and you're not saved, it's because you choose to be that way. You say, Doug, now come on. Don't it take the Holy Spirit to draw you? Have you been to Beach Fork very long? The Holy Spirit walks around this place all the time. And I guarantee you, he's been on your doorstep knocking at your heart's door. And you stood back there and you've turned him away because you chose to do that. That's your choice. Me or Tom can't come back and drag you. And if we did, it wouldn't do you no good until you made up your mind that you wanted to change. Am I making that clear? Look here. Nobody tied Eve down and made her take that apple from that tree. Nobody did that. She made the choice to reach out and get a hold of the fruit, and Adam was right there with her. So we can't blame the woman. The man was standing right beside her. And they both sinned. They both sinned against God. And finally tonight, last point is this. When we can't blame others and we can't blame the devil, who does that leave to blame? And I've known people to do it. They blame God. They blame God. So too often, we find that we can't blame the devil, we can't blame others, so we blame God. After all, he's responsible for everything, isn't he? He's the one that gave me this family that I have that's wicked. He's the one that gave me these rotten friends that make me do bad things. He's the one that gave me no willpower to say no against them. So therefore, he has to be to blame, right? Sorry, no. He's not. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. I used to drill this to my young people when I had them those some years ago. This verse right here. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. There hath no temptation taken you but such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation always make a way of escape that ye may be able to bear it. Did you catch that? There's always an escape door. There's always a way out. There's always no. There's always, I can't do that. There's always, it ain't going to hurt their feelings. It don't matter if it does. You're allowed to say no. Walk away from that. Don't do anything in that. So what that does for you and me, it lets us know that there has been a way made of escape. But the choice is up to us, what we choose. We can choose to escape with the help of the Lord, or we can fall into the trap of temptation. I love this right here. I throw this in here. I love this. I might have told this here before, but Max Lucado wrote a book. And in this book, it says this. He wrote these words. It's quiet. It's early. My coffee's hot. The sky is still black. The world is still asleep. In a few moments, the day will arrive. The stillness of the dawn will be exchanged for the noise of the day. The refuge of the early morning will be invaded by decisions to be made and deadlines to be met. I think today I will choose the good things from God. I want to choose to love, choose to have joy, take on peace, be patient, show kindness, look for goodness, be faithful, show gentleness, and have self-control. To these I commend my day. If I succeed, I'll give thanks. If I fail, I will seek His grace. Then, when the day is done, I will place my head on the pillow to rest, because I have known that I have chosen the good things God has laid before me. Ain't that good? Sometimes our days start out bad. Sometimes bad things happen, and we got to deal with it. We got to try to keep going, and we get sidetracked. But if we could start our day, like he said this morning, 15 minutes early, get up and read our Bible and pray and start our day like that, we're choosing the good things. We're choosing the good things. We sometimes blame God, but we must know that God is good. Now listen, I don't know all your hearts here. Most of you I know are Christians by your testimonies. But I don't believe there's anybody in here can stand up and have any kind of indictment on my God. There's no way. He's been way too good. Even if you're not serving Him full-hearted and you're fooling around, He's still been way too good to you. My God is a good God. And He cares for you. And He gives you life. And He keeps us safe every day. Donald Barnhouse tells of a story of his dad many years ago. A prairie fire swept through the prairie. And it got on his dad's land, and it burnt their house and their buildings and their barns. And burnt everything he had, even his livestock. He lost everything. And he said, I was out there in the field with my dad, and my dad was kicking these objects, pieces of wood and things, and just kicking and walking around, wondering what in the world to do next. I've lost everything I have. And about that time, he looked down, and he seen this charred piece of wood. And he kicked that thing, and a bunch of little baby chickens come running out everywhere. They just run everywhere. And he squatted down and he looked at that thing and flipped it over, and he seen it was an old mother hen who gave her life during that fire to protect her babies. Now, some of us is going through some rough times right now. I want you to take this story home with you this week and know that the hand of God is over top of you, and the fires of this world may sweep over top of you, but there's a day coming when we can kick that hand back and be free again, knowing that He has been in our midst and has taken care of us. Our Savior tonight loves us so much that He gave His life. We tell it all the time here. He gave His life for you and me. We don't deserve it, Jamie. We don't deserve it, but He did it anyway. He did it anyway. As a Christian, I need God's protection, because Satan is always attacking and always on the attack, attack, attack. We need His protection. But here's the thing. It's up to you. You can blame others all you want to and lose out on this thing. Or you can say, nope, Lord, it's my decision, my choice, and I'm going to get what I need. I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to get this thing by the horns, and I'm going to take care of it. Amen. I'll give you what God's given me. Let's all be standing. Let's all be standing. come to the piano. Jeff, play something, every head bowed, every eye closed.